Good morning. We start today's talk with answering a few questions that came up yesterday on chat. So the first question which came from Rangaswamy College, Center 1313, and the question is superconducting state reversible? Or rather, I should say, is superconducting transition reversible? The answer is, of course, yes, but let me sort of try to make a couple of comments on this. See, what do you mean by a reversible phase transition? By a reversible phase transition, what we mean is that if you have gone from, let us say, state A to B by some process, and if you reverse the procedure in small step following exactly that path, supposing I have gone like this from point A to B and I have arrived at this state. Now, whatever are the processes by which I went from A to B, then if I reverse it, I should come back exactly by the same path and coming back to A. So, look at, for example, the classic case of a non-reversible transition. That happens when you talk about how does the magnetization behave against an applied field in case of a ferromagnet. See, when you apply a field, initially the increase in magnetization is linear, gradually it becomes non-linear, and when all the magnetic moments have saturated, have been aligned, it sort of becomes aligned. So, this is what is known as saturation magnetization. Now, supposing I reduce the field and I go this way. Now, it turns out that it does not quite take that path, but will come like this, and even when the magnetic field has actually become 0, you will find instead of returning to the magnetization value of 0, it will still have certain amount of magnetization, and this is the what is known as the spontaneous magnetization. You want to reduce the magnetization to 0, you have to actually apply what is known as a coercive field, and then of course you have seen this BH curve completely. So therefore, this is an example of an irreversible process. Reversible process would be one if I went like this and if I came back like that. Now, let us come back to the graph that I drew for the magnetization. As I have told you, I normally plot of minus m against h, not for any reason, but I could have plotted m against h, but then my curve will be in the fourth quadrant. It sort of does not look good. Other than that, there is no reason. So, if you look at what happens to that when you apply at a particular temperature, the thing is this, that supposing you have the curve is basically this. Now, what we are trying to say is this, that look, if you now, supposing you have a superconducting state and you have achieved it by reducing the temperature. So, this is, let me come back to that, let us say I am plotting some physical quantity. I could be plotting resistance curve, let us say resistance in the absence of magnetic field. So, resistance at h equal to 0, and I am plotting it against temperature T. See, the idea is something like this, that as I have told you yesterday, that as long as I am below Tc, the curve goes as a plus bt square, and if it were not, so at certain temperature Tc, which we have talked about that temperature, so this is a normal state. And if you have go to a superconducting transition, then all this state here is a superconducting state, and the resistance or resistivity suddenly drops to 0. Now, let us reverse the procedure. Supposing I am at this temperature and magnetic field is still 0, then if I increase the temperature, I will go like this. That will, as long as the temperature T is less than Tc, the resistivity will remain 0, and then as soon as TC increases by epsilon, this I am talking about type 1 conductor, type 1 superconductor. So resistivity will suddenly rise, and after that if you increase the temperature, it will follow the usual T square behavior. So therefore, this goes to show that superconducting transition is reversible. The answer is yes. The second question is a quick question. This came from center number 1028. I have not picked up the name. It simply asks a question: do we today have room temperature superconductors? Question of what we call as high temperature superconductivity will be discussed by Professor Suresh in his last lecture, but the quick answer to that question is no. We have not achieved transition temperature which is 300 Kelvin even today. Next question is from 1152, St. Joseph College, Palai. This is a very interesting question. It says that on one hand you say superconductor is a diamagnet, on the other hand you say there is a persistent current. So I have persistent current and I have diamagnetism. A very, very, very intelligent and nice question. Is there a contradiction between these two statements? Okay. So let me first explain to you what does he mean by a contradiction. Sorry, I keep on using the word what does he mean. It could be a lady who has asked that question. So he or she, but I will not be able to be politically correct all the time. So whoever has asked that question. The point here is the following, that on one hand we say a superconductor is a perfect diamagnet, that it does not allow a flux to penetrate it. So therefore, but on the other hand we are saying that there is a persistent current which is running, which is creating its own field. Okay. Is there a dichotomy in this? The answer is no. And let me explain what the problem is. The problem is something like this. This thing that we are talking about takes place in any material which has a geometry with a hole in it. Now, somebody had asked the question, what happens in a solenoid? The thing is not whether it is a solenoid or it is a toroid or it is a ring. All the answers are similar. The point actually is this, that in the absence of a magnetic field, when I have a superconductor, then of course everything is fine, nice. But let us suppose that I start with a temperature T greater than TC. I am also simultaneously explaining the question asked by question 1100. MES Palai, right? MES Palai, yeah. So it says simply explain flux repulsion. So I am trying to answer that also along with it. The point here is the following, that supposing I start with a normal material, but the shape is such that the material has a hole in it. For instance, it could be a tube-like structure. It could be a toroidal structure, it could be a ring, whatever you like, a disc. Now the idea is this, that when you put in a magnetic field, at a temperature higher than TC, the flux lines enter, not only the material of the thing, but they will of course enter the hole also. Now let us so this is in the presence of B. Now let us decrease the temperature so that T reduces, so that the temperature becomes, it becomes superconducting. Now when it becomes superconducting, one thing is of course, since it is a perfect diamagnet, a perfect diamagnet which has a negative susceptibility of 1, it says that it doesn't allow the magnetic flux, because remember, essentially H plus M is your the magnetic field B. So therefore, what I will have in such a situation is a situation of this type. The there would be field lines outside. Close to that, because of the geometry, it will bend a little bit, but it will still be outside. But there will be flux lines in the hole, because the hole, there is no material. So there is nothing which is stopping you from having flux line in the hole. So this has expelled. Now, once it is expelled, what you do is that you switch off the magnetic field. Now, when you switch off the magnetic field, the situation that happens is the following, that you had these lines which I drew outside the material. Now, they of course simply vanish. These lines, these will simply vanish. They, in our language, they will go away to infinity, because infinity has the source and sink for everything. Forget about that. But look at those flux lines which sort of came in the hole. Now, how do these flux lines go? They can't go, because in order to move to infinity, they will have to pass through the material of the superconductor. So this is the situation, what happens when B is equal to 0. Now, of course, since there is no source, no sink, so therefore these flux line will sort of close on themselves. I'm coming back to this in connection with today's lecture when we did take up this type of geometry. Now, notice what I have. What I have is a very peculiar situation. I have magnetic flux lines outside the material, of course, but there is no source of a magnetic field. Now, how can such a thing arise? We know that the magnetic fields can be only created by means of a steady current. Now, where is the steady current? Now, like it has been pointed out, that look, I don't expect the material of the superconductor to have a magnetic field. But you see, remember that even in a conductor, we made a statement that it's not that conductor cannot have charges. The conductor certainly can have charges, but only on the surface. Because these charges are free electrons, and inside there cannot be a magnetic field. So the electric field. So here what happens is the following, that in a very small sheath here, close to the edge, there is a circulating current. This is the persistent current we are talking about. This persistent current will allow these magnetic fluxes to be sustained here. And it is it's a surface effect, and so therefore it stays. So there is nothing like a in this, if you try to do it, what is the current here? The answer is 0. So there is no contradiction here. The currents will be in a very thin surface there. Magnetic flux expansion I have talked about, but let me make another point here. I wanted to point out the fact that it is a zero, no flux, is not a consequence, I should say, not necessarily a consequence of zero resistivity. The confusion arises because of the following, that if you follow Maxwell's equation, you have del cross of A equal to minus dB by dt, this famous Faraday's law. Now, I have a superconductor, and obviously my electric field is 0. So, E is equal to 0 means curl is equal to 0. Now, if curl is equal to 0, it tells me, well, I could take the line integral of surface integral of both sides, and you know that we have been talking about it for quite some time, that del cross E dot ds is same as E dot dl. That is equal to minus d phi by dt. This is the Faraday's law. Now, if the I have del cross of E equal to 0. So therefore, I expect E to be equal to 0. So this quantity, I want it to be equal to 0. So phi is equal to constant. Now, so the phi equal to constant tells me that if I have a superconductor, there. Now, the flux inside it was 0 to begin with. Now, I have now put in a external magnetic field. Now, since the zero resistivity demands my flux cannot change, so my flux cannot enter the sample if I suddenly put in a magnetic field. So, this is not expulsion of flux. This is not allowing flux to enter in. This you can understand by means of the fact that this can be understood by means of the fact that superconductor is also a perfect conductor. The expulsion of flux means that if this material already had flux at a temperature T greater than TC, now you cool it, according to what I just now told you, the flux should, even on becoming a superconductor, because it is a perfect conductor, the flux should remain the same. This does not happen. This does not happen, the flux gets expelled. Not understandable from the point of view of a Maxwell's equation. In order to understand that, you have to have other theories. The most commonly accepted theory today is the BCS theory. I will touch upon BCS theory, but I will not be able to, it is not possible for in a course like this to actually derive the entire BCS theory. So, the expulsion of flux, like somebody has asked me to explain, well, it is not a very easy thing to explain based on ordinary electromagnetism. You need quantum mechanics for that. Okay. Next question is from 1319, which asks me the question, why do you draw the, you know, when we talk about superconductor, and we sort of said that we draw the plot in terms of the magnetization versus the magnetic field, why not T versus TC? I mean, why not magnetization versus T? Or minus m versus t. Look at what would you get? It is a question of your benefit. What would you get if you plotted the magnetization versus t? The idea is something like this, that we know that supposing you start with a superconductor, we know your susceptibility is minus 1, so that your minus m versus h curve is actually linear. Now, it remains linear at all temperature below TC, which means you have to plot a set of curves, one for each temperature, and there will be no feature in that. The moment it becomes TC and more, the m suddenly goes to 0, so again you do not need a curve for that. So, that is why you can describe the phase transition by, for example, the plot that I had of rho versus T, because there the for T greater than TC I have a normal state, for T less than TC I have this. So, magnetization versus this will not help. 1047 asks me a question, superconducting state contains both normal and superconducting electrons. So, can the equipartition principle be valid? Let me first make one comment. There is nothing like a normal electron and a superconducting electron. There is only one type of electron. What I said is the following, that before people understood the mechanism of superconductivity, there were many phenomenological theories. What is meant by a phenomenological theory? A phenomenological theory is one where you take certain experimental fact. Now, these are given to you by experiment, which you cannot change it. Now, once you have taken some experimental fact, you try to say that, okay, let me make minimum number of assumptions. Now, if with my minimum number of assumptions, which may not always be rigorously justified, I can explain the phenomena, then all that I do is that later on search for whether that had any basis or not. So, since people had no quantum basis for understanding the superconductivity, what they did is to say that, all right, this is behaving funny. So, maybe there are some of those electrons which are, and this came up particularly because of the discovery of type 2 superconductors. The type 2 superconductors were funny because they were partially allowing flux to enter in. There was a question of partial entry of flux as a function of the magnetic field. Now, so people said that maybe there are two types of electrons. One type of electrons, let us call them red electrons, they are the ones which behave normally, they carry entropy, they can scatter against things like ions, and if you want, for which the equipartition principle is valid, provided you are in classical physics. There is another type of electron, which we call as the green electron, let us say. Now, notice, I am using now a phenomenological thing. Let us suppose there is a red electron, there is a green electron. There is nothing like a red electron and a green electron. I am just giving it as an illustration. So, they said there is another type of electron or another fraction of electrons which do not carry entropy, which in the presence of an electric field will simply go by Newton's law, not and move without resistance. Now, this is a phenomenological assumption. So, there is no question by which I can explain this. The next question, next question was on explain penetration depth, which was not very clear. I will do that because they were the last slides, so therefore, I will take care of it. And another question which came by your forum is the energy gap is delta. Why do we talk about 2 delta always? Okay. Now, this is a good question. See, basically what we are trying to say is this, that superconductor has an energy gap of 2 delta. Now, but on the other hand, as you will become clear in when I talk about the Cooper pairs, the superconductivity arises because there is not one electron which is participating it at a time, but pairs of electrons are participating it at a time. So, if you want to break superconductivity, if you want to make it normal, you have to break a pair. In other words, supposing a pair were here, and this is a coupled pair, then when you break it, and you want to take it there, each of the electrons has to be promoted to that level. That is, each electron must at least be excited by an energy delta. And that is why, since there is a pair of electron, I need 2 delta for that. So, with that, I complete the question, maybe some clarification on the questions themselves. Yeah, Gyanamani College, you have a clarification on the questions, please go ahead.
The main purpose of the superconductor is that we consider only the current factors. Is it correct? It is true or not, sir?
See, there is nothing like a purpose of a superconductor. There are material which behave like that way. So, it is not that superconductor's purpose is to talk about current factors. There are material, these are physical things like copper, aluminum, etc. are conductors. In fact, it is very surprising that most of the cases, particularly when you come to the HTFC, you will find materials which become superconductor at a temperature below TC, in their normal state, they are rarely good conductors. So, for example, you know, I mean, the, you notice copper. Now, the copper has such a low transition temperature, a superconducting transition temperature, that copper will not become a superconductor at reasonably low temperature as well. So, it is not true that good conductors will become superconductor if you raise their temperature. That correct statement is not true. SGS College of Technology, you have a question?
Yesterday you specified that conductors have positive temperature coefficient and semiconductors have negative temperature coefficient. So why this could be possible, as in both the cases amplitude of vibration of electrons?
No, don't go so fast. You said yesterday I mentioned that resistivity coefficient for conductors is different from the resistivity coefficients of semiconductor. Yes, but what is your question on that?
The temperature coefficient of conductors is positive.
Yes.
And that of semiconductor is negative.
Yes.
So, but amplitude of vibration of electrons in both the cases.
Yes. Okay, I have understood your question. So, let me explain. See, the point actually is this, the following. That you see, you have to realize first that conductor has a lot of free electrons available. So, the basic problem in conductor when you increase the temperature is the following, that look at what is the simplest mechanism. I will explain that answer in two ways, both with respect to our classical way of understanding what is conduction and with respect to the quantum way. So, the way it happens is this, that the when you are talking about electrons participating in conductivity, what happens really? So, basically the electrons, when you are subjecting them to an electric field, they are moving around, okay, going from one end of the wire to another. That is because they are free. Now, when they are going, they, because there are ions which are more or less fixed at their positions, okay, they also bump against those fixed ions. Now, so when they bump against it, they are, you know, there will be a collision between them, typically elastic collision, and their velocity direction would be changed. Elastic collision velocity magnitude will not be changed. So, but they will proceed till they meet another collision. Now, this is what happens. Now, if you raise the temperature, now as you said that there would now be a vibration of the these ions. Now, when these ions vibrate, the probability of collision with the electron or probability that an electron collides against an ion becomes more. That is, the ion, the electron gets more resistance to its motion. Imagine you are in a room with fixed chairs. Now, these chairs are fixed, so therefore, you can avoid the chairs and go. Once in a while, we will hit the chair, but you can go out of the room. But suppose now that some of your friends are continuously moving those chairs in random fashion. Now, your possibility of hitting that chair as you are trying to move out of the room becomes more. So, you incur more resistance. Now, so as a result, as the temperature rises, the vibration amplitude rises. So, you are absolutely right, and because of that it happens. Now, your question was that why didn't it happen in case of a semiconductor? You see, in semiconductor there is a dip. There is another effect which is much more important, and that effect is because of the fact, remember in the conductor there is nothing like a band gap, whereas in semiconductor there is a band gap. Now, first thing that happens when you raise the temperature is, now in semiconductor, for example, at zero temperature, intrinsic semiconductor, there is nothing like a conducting electron because the valence band is full. Now, when you raise the temperature, the collision becomes a secondary effect there, because the number of electrons is so few anyway. The first effect is there are no electrons in the conduction band, there are now electrons in the valence band. So, there is something to conduct. So, the number of electrons participating in conductivity rises. So, your n value rises. So, there are two effects there. You are right that it is not very different, the amplitude of vibrations would remain the same, but you see there was nothing to conduct. There are now electrons there. So, therefore, there will be some conductivity and conductivity will increase. Is it clear?
Sir, one more question.
Yeah.
Sir, yesterday we have seen the magnetic field expulsion from superconductor.
Yes.
But it might be that at certain depth over the surface of metal, magnetic flux cannot be cancelled completely. So is this depending on the intensity of magnetic field or shape of sample?
No. See, the magnetic flux expulsion, say like in conductor, if you apply an electric field, I know that in the bulk of the conductor, in main conductor, there I am not talking about a current carrying conductor, because current conductor there is a battery. Okay, supposing you subject it to an electric field due to static charges and all that. Now, the inside the bulk of the conductor, the electric field has to be zero. But the there would be induced charges generated in a on the surface. So, what we are trying to say, this is what I am going to anyway come back to the explanation of that, that there is a skin depth distance there. The it is not that the a magnetic field flux does not penetrate at all. It does penetrate a little bit, but it very quickly dies out. That is the whole idea, that there is a depth to which it goes, something like the skin depth in case of a conductor. Okay. Let me, since we have already taken up our, please continue to send questions. I understand that today is the last lecture on superconductivity, but I will take up questions that are raised today, maybe tomorrow in the part of the optics session. There is no, because the questions are coming in, so I will answer. Okay. So, let me now go over to the main lecture. So, before I concluded yesterday and also during my clarification today, I talked about some phenomenological theories due to London brothers. They are called two fluid model. And remember that these were before Bardeen-Cooper's theory of superconductivity came into the picture. So, we said that there are two types of electrons. One type of electron are the usual electrons, which are normal electrons, which carry entropy, contributes to conductivity, suffers resistance, and so that has this type of a structure. Another type of electron, which does not offer any resistance, moves just following Newton's law, and that is that fraction is your MS. So, that is the what London assumed. Now, so we said, he said that the total charge density or number density of electrons consists of a normal fraction and a superconducting fraction. And the current density, which is of course obtained by multiplying with the charge, is also a normal current density and a superconducting current density. Now, it is this JS that we are interested in. Jn we understand, this is our usual dissipative thing. The superfluid, they are called fluid in a two fluid model, satisfies, so normal one satisfies J equal to sigma I, Ohm's law. The second one is dJs by dt. Now, Js is n times velocity, number time velocity is the current, you can multiply with the charge. Then, so this becomes, there is a E missing here. The normal, the superconducting fraction, the charge which was missing here, and d by dt of Vs. Now, this d by dt of Vs is by Newton's law equal to minus Ee, because that is the force. So, therefore, I get ns E square over m into E. So, it tells me that dJs by dt is proportional to E. So, I can write E as equal to, after bringing that m by ns E square to the left hand side, I define that quantity as some capital lambda. So, I get electric field is given by rate of change of capital lambda Js. So, what we are now trying to talk about is this, that supposing I took this, okay, and set up as I did yesterday a equation from the electromagnetism, what I get is the following. I assume that I have semi-infinite slab. Now, what is meant by semi-infinite slab? Firstly, it is in two directions it is infinite. So, for example, supposing the x direction is from 0 to infinity. Now, that is a semi-infinity because the minus infinity to 0 is not included. Y and z direction are infinite. Now, this symmetry tells us that there cannot be a variation in the y and z direction because after all they are symmetric. So, only variation that is possible is in the x direction. So, therefore, your equation for the magnetic field or whatever del square H that becomes can only vary in the x direction. And I had shown you yesterday that it gives me a solution of the type that Hx equal to H0, the surface value, and it falls up exponentially. And typically a skin depth is always defined as the depth at which the surface value becomes reduced by a factor of 1 over E. So, by a factor of E. So, that is 37%, that has been the electrical convention for years. Now, this depth at which the magnetic field strength which has penetrated the sample becomes 1 over Eth of its value is known as the London penetration depth. Now, this penetration depth, for example, in aluminum it is about 500 nanometer angstroms, that is 50 nanometers, and well, this is roughly this order, but if you take the current high temperature superconductors, they are much more. Okay. So, that takes care of what we did yesterday. Let me now come back to today's talk. Now, I also spent a bit of a time in explaining what happens to this flux. So, basically I tried to tell you that supposing I take any substance which has a hole in it, a solenoid with a tube, which is a tube, and inside there is a magnetic field established. Or just take a ring, have an external magnetic field, there are flux lines which are passing, make it a superconductor. Now, when you make it a superconductor, the flux lines cannot be outside. If the flux lines are not outside, then they can be inside the hole. Now, when they are inside the hole, the reason why they continue to be inside the hole is that they cannot get out. If they tried to get out, they have to enter the superconductor, and superconductor is not going to allow it. All right. So, then when I switch off the magnetic field, since the flux lines have no sources, this is the picture that you find. The flux lines must close on themselves. And as we explained a little while back, this requires that there must be a persistent current in a small thickness of its surface. Now, that is understandable, but what is important is that the measurement of these fluxes, they found something very interesting. They found that the flux is not just anything, but the flux is quantized in this unit, H by 2 E unit. In fact, this factor 2 keeps on coming back to haunt us, that is because 2 electrons are always involved. So, in other words, you will find phi naught, the flux that is there, can be either H by 2 E or 2 H by 2 E, 3 H by 2 E, like this, but not any fraction thereof. So, the trapped flux is also quantized. Now, let us try to understand why trapped flux is quantized. I will try to explain it to you on the basis of again very basic, I mean phenomenological old quantum theory if you like. Remember your Bohr-Sommerfeld model of quantization, which you had utilized in case of Bohr model. Now, in Bohr model we had said that the angular momentum is quantized, and the way Bohr derived it is this, that since I have circulating current, remember this Bohr's argument, that since there is a circulating current, the charge which is circulating, moving in a circle, obviously is being accelerated. Now, an accelerating charge must radiate. The accelerating charge did not radiate in Bohr model. So, therefore, there was a condition on it. They said that this is, you see, normally an accelerating charge would radiate and then it will lose all its energy and the electron will fall back on the nucleus. Now, in order to stop it, what Bohr had suggested is that there should be a statement in Bohr model which says that there are stable orbit in which such radiation doesn't take place. But what they needed was a statement that integral of P dot dl, if you are talking about the a circulating electron in Bohr model, it says integral of P dot dl is a multiple of H. This is there in any school textbook. Now, we all know that when you put on a magnetic field, the role of the momentum is taken by P minus, I have put in not E A, but I have put in E star. Ultimately, this E star will become 2 E. So, P minus E A. Well, those of you who are using other units, you might find in the books it says P minus E A by C, but that is all right. We are using SI units. So, in other words, this thing which says P dot dl equal to NH has to be replaced by P plus E star A dot dl is equal to NH. Now, so therefore, and this quantity, remember this P is now an ordinary MV. So, it tells me by separating it, MV dot dl plus E star A dot dl is equal to NH. Now, so far as this term is concerned, you are taking this over a circuit, and so therefore, as it returns back to that point, the line integral of V dot dl over a circuit must be equal to 0. So, I am left with E star A dot dl is equal to NH. Now, this A dot dl I had shown you is nothing but flux, and you remember what we did. We said that look, the you convert this into del cross A dot ds using the inverse of the Stokes theorem. See, Stokes theorem said that surface integral of a curl is the line integral. So, I am saying this line integral is equal to surface integral of del cross A, but del cross A is my magnetic field. Surface integral of del cross A is nothing but my flux. So, integral A dot dl is an equivalent expression for the flux. So, my flux is given by E star phi, there is E star there, it is equal to NH. This is from Bohr-Sommerfeld condition, which tells me that this phi is nothing but NH by E star, which is NH by 2E. And this is a very simple explanation using old quantum theory. And this I am plotting from a, the picture is not very good because I have taken the picture from a journal, and it tells you about the way the fluxes change as your you know, the strengths etcetera increase. So, you notice these coming steps. It is this value, it keeps this value, and then suddenly it will jump, okay. When you increase the magnetic field, it jumps from here to here. So, this step picture is what you get. So, let me now go over to some qualitative description of the BCS or the Bardeen-Cooper-Schiffer theory. So, Cooper was a graduate student with Bardeen when this theory was done, and in fact about Bardeen I would like to tell you something that you know, there are already very few people who got Nobel Prize, and still fewer people who got Nobel Prize twice, okay. And there are just two people who managed to get a Nobel Prize in the same subject twice. I mean, of course, there are people who got two Nobel Prizes. Madame Curie got it once in physics, once in chemistry. Linus Pauling got it once in chemistry, once in peace. But I am talking about people who got Nobel Prize in the same subject. Bardeen is one of them. Bardeen got twice Nobel Prize, once for this theory that I am talking about in physics, and second time again in physics for his contribution to the discovery of transistors. Okay, two different areas totally, but that is why Bardeen is so famous. Alright, Cooper was a student. So, the point was that what the problem that Cooper was doing, it is goes as Cooper's problem, that they found that it is possible to think in terms of an attractive interaction. I know I am using words which you will find very disturbing, but let me explain that to you. Due to an attractive interaction between a pair of electrons. you know that pair of electrons normally have a repulsive Coulomb interaction. So what is this attractive interaction? So let me explain that how it happens. It is not a direct interaction. So imagine an electron moving through a lattice. You have been talking about solid state already. So you know that the structure of a solid, it has ions in it which are arranged in a geometrical structure which we call as lattice. So imagine an electron or electrons entering a region of a metal, okay, and with some typical velocities, typically 10 to the power 5 meter per second, etc. Now the what it will do is this, that because the electron has charge, that because the electron has a negative charge, the ions have a positive charge. Now this electron in its way as it is traveling can polarize ions. Now what does it mean? It means that because the ions are positive, the presence of this negative charge as it is moving will disturb these ions a little bit from their own position, mean position, because the, in other words, close to the positions of the ions, there would be a redistribution of the positive charges. Now, but however, the electron is moving at a very high speed, so it polarizes the medium and goes away. Now, but as it moves away, supposing a second electron is coming in now. Now, this second electron finds that the electron which we talked about earlier has already pulled the ions a little upward or little closer to its path. So, as a result, the electron experiences an attractive force which is stronger than it would have had if the first electron was not there. So, this means that in effect there is an attractive interaction between the two electrons which happened due to or mediated due to this vibrating ion, if you like, which it has been able to polarize. This is also called due to phonons, because the vibrating ions are basically phonons. So, as a result, what we have got is an effective interaction between the pairs of ion which is attractive. Now, mind you, they are at fairly large distances, large in some scale I will talk about. But the because of this fact that the first electron has polarized the ions, so the that is what I mean by polarizing ions is that it has created region with more positive charges than it had. So, therefore, the second electron feels an attraction. So, therefore, what I got is an effective interaction between the electron pair which is attractive in nature. Now, how do I even know it is correct? Now, in other words, is there any evidence of the fact that the ions are participating in the process of superconductivity? Because till now I have remained silent about ions. I have never said that the ions were there anywhere. Okay, we said these are electrons. Now, if I look at the transition temperature, the critical temperature of various material and their isotopic mass, you understand what is an isotopic mass. A substance having the same atomic number but having different neutron numbers, that is its charge is the same but the mass is different. Now, people have found that the transition temperature inversely varies as the 1 over square root of the mass, Tc, there is a mistake there, m to the power half. Okay? So, in other words, there is evidence of the fact that ionic mass is actually playing a role there. So, Cooper was asked by his professor to work out on this problem. Cooper was asked that, look, can you find out? Now, remember our idea of what is a metal. Now, my electron in a conductor or was filling, for example, all the states up to Fermi energy, or they were in what is called a Fermi sea. Now, what we are saying is this, that talk about two electrons which are inside the Fermi sea, but instead of talking about attractive repulsive interaction, imagine they have an attractive interaction, no matter how small it is, as long as they are attractive. Now, solve the quantum mechanical problem of these two electrons. This is what Cooper did. This is what Cooper did and found out that this pair, which has an attractive interaction between them, will become unstable against Fermi C. In other words, the lowest energy state would be one in which the energy of the pair happens to be lower than the Fermi energy. So that would be the preferred thing. Now, what we are talking about is this. Now, notice the energy will obviously increase if the momentum of the pair is taken to be large or non-zero. So what we do is we say that energetically the most favorable situation is that for which the pair of electrons which are interacting via an attractive indirect interaction, their momentum is taken to be zero. This pair is called a Cooper pair. Now, this is a picture which you will see very frequently. So basically what we are saying is this, that there is an electron which is shown by a negative charge which comes. Now imagine what the phonon is doing is to bind them by something like a spring, bind the two electrons by a spring. Maybe they are far apart, but on the other hand they are, this is a loose picture and this is a phonon. So the electron continues to exchange phonon with the other electron, and though they are both negatively charged, but because they are bound by a phonon, it remains attractive. So this is the picture. Now, what am I trying to say here? We said that look, supposing this is my Fermi surface, this is the field Fermi C, this is the field Fermi C, and I am talking about two electrons there, and these two electrons, I have taken the momentum to be 0, which means if one has a wave vector k, the other one has a wave vector minus k, and this two pair would then have an energy which is lower than the Fermi energy. And what we are trying to say is this, that the superconductor essentially has large number of such pairs of electrons, and this pair of electron is called a Cooper pair. And this was actually his PhD thesis. So you can imagine at what young age he worked it out. Now, the wave function of the pair, I write it the usual way. I have the position of one, position of the other. I have taken the usual block electron type of behavior, and uk e to the power ik dot r1 minus r2, and this if it is even, the function could be this way. If it is odd, the function could be that way. But the supposing the now I am talking about two electrons. You know that when I talk about electrons, they are fermions. Now, since the electrons are fermions, I can't allow two electrons to sit on the same place. But on the other hand, if that happens, that the even, the odd term, right, means my wave function will then become 0. But only the even term will allow two electrons to sit one over the other. Now, but total wave function is a product of the space wave function and the spin wave function. If the space part is even, cosine is an even function, then spin part has to be antisymmetric. That is, if I am talking about a pair, say I must have only singlet possible combination. Okay. Now, you will hear a term which is known as characteristic length in superconductor called coherence length. In fact, typically one talks about two characteristic lengths in superconductors. One is the coherence length, which is usually written as xi, and this is the length over which the Cooper pairs can maintain phase coherence, and this can be as large as something like about 1.6 few micrometers to as low as 40 nanometers in case of niobium. Aluminum has a very large coherence length. Okay. So these are the things that we are talking about, and the lower state is separated from the normal state, okay, by of the order of a fraction of MeV. This is the gap. This is the gap, and the presence of the gap is verified by standard tunneling experiments and the specific heat in activation energy. All right. So So this is what we are talking about, that the Fermi energy of in a superconducting state is lower than that in the normal state, and there is a gap between the normal state and the superconducting state, and that is my delta. As I told you while explaining, somebody had asked why do we talk about two delta. That's because becomes clear now, because I have to break two electrons and take both of them above the gap. So let me come to a little more. I will not be solving equations, but let me talk about some things. See, in the quantum mechanics course, you wrote down how to write down a Schrodinger equation. So that was your usually the way we write it down is I h cross d psi by dt. There might be a minus sign wrong here. Is the p square by 2m plus the v psi, of course. Now this term, as I have been pointing out repeatedly, the momentum becomes momentum minus your qa or e star a, and momentum operator is minus I h cross del. And this phi, okay, is just a scalar potential in which these things are there. So this is my wave function. I will not solve this, but without solving it, we will be able to make some comments about it. So the thing is the following. Let us talk about what is the ground state of a superconductor. In the superconducting state, I have electrons, but pairs of electrons are bound. The pairs of electrons are bound together, okay? And this is now there is a difference between saying I have two electrons and I have saying that I have a pair, because it can be shown that this pair, which is bound, it behaves like a boson. Not each individual electron, they are fermions, but this pair can be shown to behave like a bosons. Now, if they are bosons, then there can be many pairs in one state, because remember, it is the Pauli exclusion principle which does not allow fermions, two fermions to occupy the same state. But on the other hand, if you have bosons, there is no such restriction. So therefore, in my lowest state, all my pairs have the same momentum. I have taken them to have zero momentum. That is the lowest energy state. So basically, I have a gas of bosons which are in the zero momentum state. Okay. So let us look at then, it becomes now a very simple job to do. Suppose I talk about that occupancy of the lowest state is n. What it tells me is this, that this occupancy of the lowest state is higher than any other state. By remember, your amplitude of the wave function is square root of the probability density. So therefore, if I write now I am writing down not the wave function of a single electron, okay? I am writing down wave function for the entire system of electrons or entire system of Cooper pairs. So I write down my wave function as square root of rho, which is taken as a real, and e to the power I theta. And both of these, I will take them to be real, because any complex number can be always split like this, that I can write any complex number as a e to the power I theta. So I have one part which is a real part rho r, and another part is e to the power I theta, which is the phase part. Now, if you now substitute this psi of r into the expression for the probability current density, remember your probability current density from quantum mechanics, it simply says minus I h cross del, well psi should have been inside here also, del psi star psi plus the complex conjugate thereof. Now in this particular case, there should have been a psi here. In this particular case, my probability current density expression, if you simply substitute here, I have to simply take a gradient and things like that. I get h cross by m del psi minus, I have used q instead of e star because I am getting this star confused with this star. So, let us put it this way, q by h cross a rho. So, this is what happens to the probability current density. Simply, this is a very trivial arithmetic, substitute here and write it like this. I will go to some of the questions. Questions seem to be piling up, but before that, let me make one or two comments. So, I have said that I have a wave function for the collection of the pair, and that is given by root rho r, which is a real thing, times a phase factor e to the power theta. The one comment I want to make is, I know a wave function is a single valued thing. In other words, supposing I am here and I come back by this path again back to the same place, I could not have changed my wave function. Okay? So, this means that if I go around any circuit, okay, a loop, so that the theta changes by either 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi, etcetera, that is a multiple of 2 pi, then I must have the value of psi to be the same, right? So, suppose I do this, I am well within a superconductor. I am considering a superconducting ring, and not, I am not near the edges where I have seen there can be persistent current, but I am within the material of the superconductor. Then my current density must be 0 because there is no current supported here, and the expression for the current density was here. So, if this quantity is 0, then I get delta theta equal to q by h cross a, right? So, that is what I get. Now, notice this, that, so let me now calculate how much is integral of a dot dl on this. See, phi is integral a dot dl, that is my flux, and now you write down that we have said delta theta is q by h cross a. So, therefore, that becomes a is equal to h cross by q a delta theta. So, that is what I have written down there. And when you complete a circuit, the integral of delta theta has to be a multiple of pi. So, I have written it as 2 n pi. That tells me the flux phi is n h by q. And this is because h cross has a h by 2 pi in it, 2 pi 2 pi cancels out, and I am left with this. So, this is the whole story about the flux quantization. Before I go to Josephson junction, let me take up a few questions. Yes, KK Wog Institute, please go ahead.
Sir, in an electric circuit,
yeah,
if any one of conducting wire is replaced by superconducting wire,
yeah,
then what will be the mechanism?
See, the point is this, that the you are saying that you have an electric circuit where you connect two parts of a circuit by means of an external wire which is a superconductor, assuming you can do it by maintaining only that part of the circuit at a temperature lower than the critical temperature. All that it means, you do not expect anything great, and I will tell you why. Because even today, when you connect your circuit by copper wires, you do not expect a drop of voltage along the copper wire because copper is fairly highly conducting. So, all that you are saying is, now I have connected them by ideally resistance less wires. Now, in all your electric circuit, you also assume that the lead wires, they do not contribute to any resistance. So, if you ask what will happen, the answer is theoretically something will go wrong or be different, but it will not matter at all from what, when you take, for example, a good quality copper wire or any such thing. Because today the type of purity that you can get in copper is very good, and copper has excellent conductivity. So, yes, there would be theoretically a difference because you have connected them by what is ideally lossless, but if you had a copper wire, in principle you have to worry about there is a voltage drop between the point of connection to the other point because there is a current passing, but superconductor there is no such issue, but nothing great happens. Knowledge Institute, yes, go ahead. Yes, madam.
Question is related to superconducting phenomenology.
Yeah.
Suppose if you are taking the superconducting ring, we are having persistent current and diamagnetism.
Yeah.
Suppose if you are taking in the shape of bar, what happens to that phenomena?
Shape of? Question.
Suppose the shape, instead of ring, if you are using a bar
yeah
as a solid, what happens to this phenomena?
Nothing really. You see, the ring was very special because what happened is, you see, if you take a bar, the flux is simply expelled out. You see, what is the way in which you understand the flux lines or field lines? See, what we normally do is this. Take, let me explain it by talking about, supposing I have a positive charge. You have seen how positive charge, electric field lines due to positive charges are written. Because the, let me take a positive charge, and what will happen is that you will draw lines which start from that source and go to infinity, right? That is because at infinite distance, I assume there is a sink also. So, all the field lines are drawn like that. Now, if you have take a bar and you subject it to, you make its temperature lower. Now, then supposing you had some flux going through it because you had subjected to a magnetic field. Now, then you make reduce the temperature. By Meissner effect, the flux will be expelled out. So, what will happen is close to that bar, the field lines will bend, okay, because they cannot enter in, and there would be, these are the fringing effects that you have seen while drawing magnetic field lines, etc., even for ordinary conductors, right. Now, the, so close to that bar, the field lines will bend, they will not enter, and so there would be certain amount of edge effects that you will see. But because there is no trapping of the flux, the thing that happened in case of a ring or a tube will not take place here. So, a bar is a much simpler thing to explain because the moment you switched off, all the flux lines vanished because they have all gone away to infinity. MS Bidway Indian College. Yes, go ahead. Yes.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, what is Fermi Dirac distribution?
See, the thing is this, that there are all the fundamental particles that we have. Now, I am talking about quantum mechanics. All the fundamental particles that we have, they can be classified into two groups depending upon what is the way they behave. The first type, that known as fermions, the fermions have this property that they satisfy Pauli exclusion principle. In other words, no two fermions, have identical fermions, can occupy the same quantum state. Now, the bosons are the other one, they are called bosons. I am sure many of you know that the name boson came from S.N. Bose, who was actually an Indian physicist. And so, there are two classes of fundamental particles. Now, if you consider the first category, namely the fermions, now the by statistics what we mean is that what gives you, how is the probability distribution, okay, at an arbitrary temperature. Now, remember when you had a classical gas, you said that in classical gas, if you are looking at the fraction of let us say whatever is the gas, which have an energy E. Now, you go by what is called a Boltzmann factor. Higher the energy, lower is the occupation. Now, this is generally true because nature likes to have, I think somebody is using a flash there. Anyway, so nature likes to have lower energy states occupied more than the higher energy state. Now, if you have a collection of electrons, for example, or protons or neutrons, all of them are fermions, okay, then if you now say that what is the fraction, okay, occupying an energy epsilon, okay, now this fraction would be given by a factor. Now, this distribution is called a statistics. The fact, how are the electrons distributed energetically. So, in Fermi, Dirac comes in because this form was with Fermi and Dirac. Fermi Dirac statistics is applicable to fermions, which says that if you have and if you consider an energy epsilon, then the fraction of electrons which have an energy epsilon is given by a factor which is not exactly the Boltzmann factor as we talked in case of a classical gas, but 1 by e to the power your energy epsilon minus a term known by as the chemical potential, all occasionally called Fermi energy, divided by kT plus 1. In case of boson, it will be a minus 1. So, Fermi-Dirac statistics, if you like, tells you how are the energy states occupied if you connect, consider an collection of fermions.
One more question, sir.
Yeah.
Type 2 superconductors.
Yeah.
In the type 2 superconductors.
Yes, I am hearing you, yes.
In between HC1 and HC2.
Yeah.
The Messner effect is not satisfied.
Okay.
That is in mixed state, sir.
Yeah.
Why, sir?
Yeah. So the point actually is this, that the it is not true that Meissner effect is not satisfied. Meissner effect is incomplete there. Okay, this is a property of the superconductor. The Meissner effect is incomplete. What happens is that when you have exceeded HC1, now supposing you had a type 1 superconductor, the moment HC is exceeded, the superconductivity is totally destroyed. In other words, it allows the flux to penetrate completely. But the in type 2 superconductors, between HC1 and HC2, there is a part entry of the flux. Now, you are asking why? The general belief is the following. I can just tell you, because this is not a course in which one can go to the quantum theories. The general belief is this, that what happens in type 2 superconductors in the intermediate region, what is also called a mixed state, is that there are regions in which the material becomes normal. Now, what is found is these regions which is there appear in the forms of tubes. Okay? That is what I mean by tubes is they are very localized distribution there. And so therefore, in the mixed state, what I have is a collection of such, these are called vortices. And it turns out that these vortices like to arrange themselves in a lattice, and they are called vortex lattice. So therefore, what I have is a material where the mostly it is superconducting, but there are areas where which have now become normal, and this normal part can behave like any other normal metal. So it is because of that the mixed state arises. But complete understanding of what is a mixed state, we need to go to theory of type 2 superconductors, which cannot obviously be talked here. All right, I have very little time now. So what I will do in this time is the following. I would like to, in fact, in case this lecture is not complete, when I come back in the later part in the afternoon to talk about optics, I might take a part of the lecture on to complete this, because I have only 15 minutes left and I don't think I can finish Josephson junction in that. But Josephson junction is such an interesting quantum phenomena and phenomena connected with superconductivity that it is better to talk about it. So, okay, according to my colleagues here, what I would do is I will go to, because the questions are piling up, and because my superconducting session is only likely to last only one, you know, this lecture, what I am going to do is this. I have Josephson effect, which explaining it properly will take half an hour, which I don't have. I will do it in the evening session. So let me finish the remaining 10-15 minutes in simply taking more questions. Yeah, so Sushila, yeah, so go ahead please. Kolhapur.
Good morning, sir.
Yes, good morning, madam.
My question is, which property of superconductor is to be improved in order to increase critical temperature up to the room temperature? Means which property we need to focus more?
I wish I knew that question's answer. In fact, many scientists, they are wondering if they know the answer to that question. Okay, her question is that what do you need to do to increase the critical temperature of a superconductor? Now, you see, the point is this, that the type of temperature we are talking about today, there are elemental superconductors or the conventional BCS type superconductors where the temperature, the maximum temperature achieved is about 23 degrees Kelvin or so. Okay? But we are not talking about that type of temperature. we are not talking about temperatures, which ideally I guess what you mean is, can we go to 300 degrees Kelvin? Okay, that is the room temperature. Now, the thing is the following, that what we have found is the following, that there are certain materials, particularly cuprates, which Professor Suresh will describe in detail, which have this property that they remain super, they are all type 2 superconductors, but they remain superconducting for a much higher temperature than most of the others are. Okay. So, the idea is more a answer to your question is more a material science question than so much a physics question. See, what they have to do is to examine what are the type of materials which seem to be having, you know, they have to look at something like, if you like, a periodic table. It is not really a periodic table, but a table of materials versus their critical temperature, and see that which, what are the differences between them. For example, you take, let us say, cuprate, the YBCO. Now, then you knew that if I put in some amount of nitrogen, what happens? So, what is happening today is, if you like, alchemy by physicists and chemists. Why it is alchemy is that you are just shooting in the dark, that you are trying to say, okay, let me add this material, try to see whether the temperature is increasing or not. So, what we are trying to do is, there does not seem to be a very methodical or scientific answer to your question as yet. I mean, it probably is there, but at this moment it is not there. What people are trying to do is trying their luck by changing compositions. In fact, this is precisely what our alchemists did in the past. They say, you know, or what our medical scientists do even today. See, if I ask you the question that, look, we all know what is the drug for a diabetic. Now, what should you do to improve the efficacy of a diabetic drug? Now, what are our scientists doing? They are simply trying, let us try this, let us try that, because there is nothing like a microscopic phenomena behind medicine. So, it's a phenomenology, and this is where phenomenology becomes very important. So, this is one question where I have no answer. I have no answer, but that is because nobody has an answer. So, you have to look at the material science scientists who will try out various materials, try to see that if I take, for example, this material, I applied a pressure to it, TC went down. So, obviously, that is not a good thing to do. Okay? So, sorry, this question, yeah, are you, I know you are not happy with my answer, but do you at least understand my inability to answer that question? Yes.
I have also seen variation in materials only. That's
right.
Why I asked this question.
No, so if you are a
which
student,
one of these type 1 or type 2 is more beneficial in this respect?
Mostly these are type 2, because type 1 is very restrictive, and these are the BCS type. There one has realized that you don't stand a chance of getting anything more than 23 to 25 degrees Kelvin. So we are talking about mostly type 2. Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
One question.
Yeah.
Why do various superconductors have a different TC?
Well, ask madam, who is a material scientist. So, same answer. See, properties of material is not something which is explained on the basis of a thoroughly microscopic theory. And this is true of why conductivity of copper is more than the conductivity of aluminum. Okay. Both of them are conducting materials. Now, what I mean, the idea is this, all of them have free electrons, but some amount of bondings which are here and there makes these behave differently. So, properties of material is something which, you know, if you want to explain it fundamentally, there is really no answer. I mean, at least nobody tries it. But one understands that, look, if we are talking about material where certain conditions can be satisfied, then it will become superconducting. But why TC of aluminum is different from TC of mercury? Okay? It is a property of the material itself. That is Abkore Institute. Yes. Go ahead with your question.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Go ahead.
I have two questions, sir. Yeah. First question is, which materials are included in high temperature superconductor,
yeah,
and what are the advantages of that?
second question you said, because I have already answered previous thing. High temperature superconductivity is not being taken up by me. There will be one full lecture on high temperature superconductivity. I am doing conventional superconductors, physics of it. Last lecture on superconductivity is on high temperature. Ask that question at that stage. Yeah, next question. You said you had two questions.
Yes, sir. Why the ferromagnetic materials are not superconductors?
Yes, that's a good question. I will be able to answer that question, at least partly. See, the thing is, you realize that in some sense, particularly when we talk about the conventional superconductor, the ferromagnetism and superconductivity are basically opposing effect. Because you remember when I wrote down the wave function for this, the paired electrons, I said they must be in singlet state. That is, their spins are opposite. And that is because I need the two electrons to be in the same state. And so therefore, I want the space part of the wave function to be symmetric. So the spin part has to be antisymmetric. So the two electrons must have their spin oppositely directed. You know, I wrote down that wave function is up, down, minus down, up by root 2. Now, on the other hand, while you are talking about a ferromagnet, you essentially are asking that the spin should be aligned. Okay. So, in other words, if I had just two particles, that is not a ferromagnet, but I am just explaining. Supposing I just had two electrons, if it is to be magnetic, then it should be a triplet and not a singlet, because singlet has S equal to 0. The magnetic moment is 0 there. So, a superconducting ground state prefers the magnetic moment to remain low. So, that is the reason why the ferromagnetism and superconductivity do not exist together. Yeah, Walchand Institute, please go ahead.
Electrons are general fermions are there.
Yes.
So, and you, Cooper pairs, you said it is that bosons.
Yes.
That, can you clarify that one?
Yes. So basically what we said is that the electrons are of course fermions, there is no question on it. But what we said is that this is a phenomena where what we find is that the electron never is alone, okay. One electron is always paired with a second electron, and it is a combination, it is a composite material that we are talking about. And this composite, okay, until you break it, it will not become a fermion, and it requires an energy of 2 delta, where delta is the band gap, to break a pair of electrons. So, in other words, they always go together. I mean, if you want to use a crude analogy, it is like the two electrons are married together, and they are always go together, okay. And this combination of composite thing, their statistics has been found to be, in fact, you can see why. You see, if two electrons, now mind you, I am not saying if you take any two electrons together, it will become bosons. I am just telling you why. The two electrons which are you know, welded to each other, if you like, by a constant exchange of boson, their total spin, right? See, each electron has a spin half. If I add two electrons, the spin can be either 0 or 1, right? This is angular momentum addition. Now, those particles which have 0 angular momentum or 1 or all integral angular momentum, their statistics is a boson. So, yes. So, that is the reason why this collection. Now, remember, do not think of it as a 2 electrons. Think of it as a Cooper pair. So, what the statement we have made is, Cooper pairs are bosons. 2 electrons are not bosons. 2 electrons are fermions. 10 electrons are also fermions. But 5 Cooper pairs are bosons. Have I made it clear? Yeah. Done? Okay, we close this session.